Cosa è successo quando tu hai visto...
What happened when you saw the London Irish Rifles for the first time in September 1943?
C'era il papà. Stavo in casa col papà.
I was still living at home with my father. He heard music and he called me and said, Angelina, come out. The English have arrived, wearing skirts. I went outside just 10 steps and I got to the corner of the street. I saw people leaning over their balconies. They took flowers from vases and threw them as thanksgiving for our freedom, because they helped us to be free.
Sicily in summer. Etna, Europe's highest active volcano. The sea is warm and inviting. It's a fertile and ancient landscape. Greeks, Phoenicians, Romans, Arabs and Normans all once lived here. Millions visit the island every year to enjoy its climate, scenery, lovely towns and villages, and unique culture. But in 1943, this was the scene of hard fighting between the armies of the Axis powers and those of the British, Canadian and American allies.
I am Richard O'Sullivan, and this is part three of All My Brothers, the story of the Irish Brigade in the Second World War.
In January 1943, US President Roosevelt and British Prime Minister Winston Churchill met in Casablanca to decide what to do once Axis forces had been expelled from French North Africa. The previous November, Erwin Rommel's Africa Corps had been defeated by the 8th Army in Egypt. Anglo-American forces had landed in French Morocco and Algeria to crush Axis forces in Tunisia, with three French support. The Allies agreed the next target would be Sicily to clear Mediterranean sea routes, knock Italy out of the war, divert enemy forces, and create the opportunity to attack the Third Reich from the south. In May 1943, Tunis was captured to end the war in North Africa. Initial orders for the invasion of Sicily were issued by General Harold Alexander later that month. It was named Operation Husky. The Allied invasion force initially comprised about 180,000 troops. Their opponents were more than 200,000 Italians and 60,000 Germans. The invasion began on the night of the 9th of July. Paratroop drops were followed by landings on 26 beaches on Sicily's southern coast. The 8th Army, led by General Bernard Montgomery, drove towards Messina. The American 7th Army, under General George Patton, advanced north and west. It entered Palermo, capital of Sicily, on the 22nd of July and started to advance east towards Messina. The invasion of the homeland shocked Italy. Its Prime Minister, Benito Mussolini, had declared war against Britain and France in June 1940. He hoped to gain territory in the Balkans, the Aegean and North Africa. But by the summer of 1943, hundreds of thousands of Italians had been killed, wounded, taken prisoner, or gone missing, including many on the Eastern Front. The Allies were bombing Italian ports. The landings in Sicily were the final straw. In Rome, on the night of the 24th of July, the Fascist Grand Council passed a vote of no confidence in Mussolini. He was arrested the following day and replaced by General Pietro Badoglio, a former Italian chief of staff. Meanwhile, the war in Sicily continued. To outflank Axis defences on the Catania plain, Montgomery decided to reinforce the attack west of Mount Etna. The 78th Battle Axe Division, which included the Irish Brigade, was given the job. The Irish Brigade was formed in early 1942. It comprised the 1st Battalion of the Royal Irish Fusiliers, known as the Fogs, the 6th Battalion of the Royal Inniskilling Fusiliers, known as the Skins, also based in Northern Ireland, and the 2nd Battalion of the London Irish Rifles, which came from London. Most of the original members of the brigade were Irish-born or of Irish descent. The Tunisian campaign was the brigade's baptism of fire. It lost around 1,000 men, either killed, wounded, missing or taken prisoner, in battles between November 1942 and the fall of Tunis in May 1943. The brigade set sail from the port of Sousse on the 26th and 27th of July and land in Sicily the following day. London Irish Rifles Colour Sergeant Edmund O'Sullivan, then aged 24, remembered the crossing.
As we left the shelter of the harbour, we were met with mountainous seas. Our large ship was heavily buffeted, but the infantry landing ships were tossed about like cockle shells. I took my bunk, occasionally going aloft to be greeted by howling winds and spindrift. Finally, we arrived. The companies literally crawled off their ships. Most had been seasick during the voyage and had had nothing hot to eat or drink, as the galley fires could not be lit.
It was along this coast in July 1943 that the Allied invasion of Sicily began. It involved more than 100,000 Allied troops from Canada, the United Kingdom and America. The campaign would last for more than a month. And it was in this area near Ognina Bay that the Irish Brigade came ashore after a very rough crossing from Tunisia.
The brigade travelled in trucks and armoured personnel carriers to Catania Nuova. It's a town north of the Detano River on the main road to Catania, which had been taken by elements of the 1st Canadian Division. The route the brigade took passes through lovely Sicilian countryside and several fine and historic towns. They included the baroque towns of Palazzolo and Vizzini, where the main town steps are paved with locally made ceramics. They are evidence of the area's historic prosperity. But this is not how Ted and his comrades saw it in 1943.
As we moved through the countryside, we were struck by its natural beauty, but appalled by the poverty of the villages and towns. Our welcome was subdued, as the people were obviously uncertain whether we were friend or foe. The Irish Brigade advanced steadily, passing through the town of Catania Nuova. Here, we became infantry once more and prepared for our attack on the centre of the enemy line at Centuripe.
The landscape has remained unchanged since the brigade gave up its transport and marched across the Detano in 1943. Centuripe occupies an interlocking web of ridges more than 2,000 feet above sea level. In July 1943, it was held by German paratroopers. It was the centrepiece of German defensive lines west of Etna. The position looked impregnable. All three of 78th Division's brigades were used in the attack. It began on the night of the 1st of August. 11th and 36th Brigade led the way, but met strong resistance. The Irish Brigade took over the assault the next day. The Skins were ordered to approach the town's central and eastern areas. They advanced in single file, uncertain where the enemy was located. The Fogs' target was Point 711, the location of Centuripe Cemetery. The London Irish were to advance to heights commanding the town's western approaches. The plan was for all three battalions to capture Centuripe in a coordinated attack, but that wasn't the way the battle went.
On the morning of the 2nd of August 1943, the 6th Battalion Royal Inniskilling Fusiliers, the Skins, moved along this track towards the town of Centuripe behind me. It was the height of summer. They were loaded down with weapons and German forces were preparing to defend the town.
The advance elements of C Company of the Skins reached this point, known as Hill 640, at 8:45 on the morning of the 2nd of August. They came under machine gun and mortar fire from surrounding high points and halted. Skins commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel Neville Graysbrook, set up his headquarters on Hill 640 and prepared to attack. Lieutenant Percy Hamilton, a Dubliner who was at the time the Skins intelligence officer, watched artillery fire being directed on German positions.
The battery commander had got the wireless up and ran a remote control to the front of Hill 640, where there was a good view. Several of us sat with him and watched him chasing a few Jerrys about with the 25-pounders, switching the guns onto whatever bit of cover they ran into. It was surprising that Jerry never fired at us, as we were sitting in the open with our legs dangling over a bank. It was a real grandstand view.
The Skins on point 640 faced a 100-foot climb to take point 708. It looked impossible. Graysbrook sent two companies to Hill 645 on the right of 640 to attack Chenteripe from there.
We were able to watch the fellas climbing up the cliff and getting to the first couple of buildings. Someone on our side dropped a smoke bomb near them, probably meant to screen them from a Jerry who had a machine gun on the right. But actually, it attracted more attention than anything else.
The attack ground to a halt. Irish Brigade Commander Nelson Russell developed a coordinated plan to take Chenteripe, but the Skins took the initiative independently. At 4:30 in the afternoon, A and C companies of the Skins attacked up Chenteripe's terraces from 640 to 708. The Skins on 645 joined the attack. 90 minutes after the Skins attack started, the London Irish assaulted hills 611, 764 and 703 to the west of Chenteripe. The fogs had reached 634 that morning and took over from the 8th Battalion of the Argyll and Sutherland Highlanders. After dark, at 8 o'clock that night, the battalion's attack started. D Company led the way. The opposition was deadly. D Company commander, Captain William Hanna, was hit by a machine gun burst and killed. The company went to ground. A second wave of fogs was sent in. All three battalions of the Irish Brigade were now engaged. Fighting went on all night. Chenteripe was finally cleared by 3 o'clock in the morning of the 3rd of August. General Montgomery visited the town soon after and said the attack up Chenteripe's terrace slopes was impossible. Winston Churchill praised the Irish Brigade's success in a speech in the House of Commons. By 3:30 in the morning of the 3rd of August, the Battle of Chenteripe was over. The Irish Brigade had taken what was at the time one of the strongest German positions in Sicily. The fogs and the London Irish led the way down Chenteripe's eastern slopes. Their next objective was to force a crossing over the River Salso. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon on the 4th of August, the fogs and the London Irish attacked. The bridge had been blown, but opposition was light. The Salso was secured by early evening. The brigade's next target was the Simeto River, about a mile to the east. It was a much tougher proposition. The bridge had been destroyed. The eastern banks were defended by more than a dozen German machine gun posts and strong points. The London Irish were given the task of crossing the river to the north of the destroyed Simeto Bridge. The fogs were to cross south of the bridge. The Skins were held in reserve. The attack started at 3 o'clock on the afternoon of the 5th of August with an artillery barrage. The Fox and the London Irish climbed down the banks of the Simeto, crossed the river and attacked German positions. The fighting climaxed around a farm building the brigade called the Palace. German defenders were eventually subdued by anti-tank piat fire. The two battalions took all their objectives by 8 o'clock in the evening.
The damage to the building behind me reflects the intensity of the fighting on the afternoon of the 5th of August 1943. More than 40 men from the Irish Brigade were killed that day. Following 4 days of rest in this area, the Irish Brigade would move on to their final objectives of the campaign.
Some of the London Irish spent time here in the village of Carcachi, now largely abandoned. There was a hidden menace.
After the Simeto battle and my company occupied Carcachi, I was allocated a large room in a house as a cookhouse. Its walls were black. As I approached, they moved. They were a mass of flies and mosquitoes. Both had painful bites and alarming consequences.
Ted caught malaria in Carcachi. He was one of thousands of Allied soldiers infected by the disease during the Sicilian campaign. The rest of the 78th Division had taken over the attack and captured Adrano on the 7th of August. The brigade resumed its advance on the afternoon of the 11th of August and travelled to Bronte. Its next target was high points around the town of Mileto, which commanded the road around the western slopes of Etna towards Messina. The plan called for the attack to start before dawn on Sunday, 12th of August. First, 36th Brigade took Mount Macarone to the south of Mileto. The Fox targets were hills called Capella and Monte Mileto, and Mileto itself. The London Irish were to take Spirina. The Skins were to take Montenave on Etna's lower slopes. The brigade had to make a nighttime cross-country march to reach its forming up points.
Compass marching is difficult in daytime. At night, there could only be one result. Some units got lost. The attack went in with the few platoons that had arrived on time at the forming up point.
The Fox assault started on time at 2:30 in the morning of the 12th of August. But the London Irish were late. Its attack went in just before daybreak, an hour after the supporting artillery barrage. H Company's attack didn't start until 10:30 in the morning. The Fox took Capella by 8 o'clock in the morning. Mileto itself was in their hands by early evening. The London Irish took their objectives as darkness fell. Their losses included F Company commander Major Joseph Fitzgerald from Dublin. He had been recommended for the Military Cross for his role in the crossing of the Simeto. The Fox continued the chase along the road to Randazzo. Its advance guard set off around 8 o'clock in the evening, the 12th of August. Around 1:30 in the morning of the next day, the Fox ran into a German ambush.
It was near here in the early morning of the 13th of August 1943 that the campaign in Sicily came to a close for the Irish Brigade. An advanced platoon of B Company of the Fogs, led by Lieutenant William Bolton from Belfast, was ambushed on the right-hand side of the road in the lava beds. Bolton was fatally wounded, as was Fusilier Edward Graham and one other Fusilier. By 8:30 in the morning, the Fogs met with an advance guard of the Americans coming from the west, near Randazzo.
On the 16th of August, Allied troops entered Messina and found most of the Germans had gone. They had never intended to fight to the last for Sicily.
The campaign, which took less than 40 days operations, was nearly over. And Monty, whose 8th Army had been given the tough assignment on the east coast, must have been well satisfied. A non-smoker himself, apparently he makes an everyday habit of giving away cigarettes. The later stages of the campaign found the Germans doing everything they could to hold up our advance, with mines and demolition. Americans were actually first in Messina, but men of the 8th Army were only beaten by a very short head, and cameramen were evidently well up in the race too. They found a bunch of civilians huddled near the entrance to the now famous tunnel shelter, waiting for the next air raid. As a matter of fact, thousands of people had been virtually living there throughout our bombardment of the city. Old Glory was hoisted at the municipal buildings. And down at the harbour, the Italian Admiral's flag, what was left of it, was hauled down and an excellent substitution made. This is one of the German evacuation beaches. Goebbels would no doubt call it a victory beach. Joy through defeat, in fact. Oh, finally, let's look across with the Allied troops to Italy. Only 2 miles away, across the straits, lies San Giovanni. That's part of the mainland of Europe, part of Hitler's fortress of Europe. The Germans' so-called Dunkirk was made across only 2 or 3 miles of sea. By the same token, that's all that separates our forces in Sicily from Axis mainland. A point worth noting by the Axis.
The Sicilian campaign was over. The Irish Brigade had again paid a high price. It had suffered 390 casualties and had lost no less than 10 company commanders. I'm now at the Commonwealth War Graves Cemetery in Catania, where more than 2,100 men are buried, including 110 men from the Irish Brigade. This is a particularly moving memorial. Irish Fusilier Edward Graham was killed around 1:30 in the morning of the 13th of August in the German ambush of a Fog's patrol on the road from Mileto to Randazzo. Until 2017, his family did not know where he was buried. In October of that year, the Commonwealth War Graves Commission finally rededicated his grave at the Catania Cemetery. The ceremony was attended by his twin sons, Edward and Sidney, who had been born just 2 weeks before their father died. Across the Irish Brigade, the losses meant promotion for the survivors. In E Company of the London Irish, Eddie Mayo, who had been awarded the military medal after being wounded in Tunisia, was promoted to sergeant. His close friend, E Company colour sergeant Ted O'Sullivan, was hospitalised in Augusta with malaria. The medical staff wanted to evacuate him to a hospital in Tripoli in Libya. He swallowed anti-malarial tablets, discharged himself, and rejoined the battalion instead. With the fighting over, the Irish Brigade were moved close to Patti on Sicily's north coast. It's a lovely spot. I'm here on the beach at Patti on the north coast of Sicily, where the Irish Brigade came at the end of the Sicilian campaign. They would spend a month here in comparative rest. I'll read a passage from my father, Ted O'Sullivan's memoirs, about that time. Patti looked out over the blue Tyrrhenian Sea. In the distance, we could see smoke and steam issuing from the volcanic island of Stromboli. The men trained and rested while I continued my never-ending task of feeding, clothing, quartering and equipping my company. This necessitated a journey to Palermo, a beautiful city. We were to spend the remainder of August and most of September in this comparative paradise. I managed to bathe in the sea most days. A little way out, seemingly, was an attractive little island, which always drew my eyes.
One evening, I foolishly decided to swim to it. I entered the sea and made towards it with steady strokes, but the island appeared to get further away. Tiring, I sensibly turned back and used an economical side stroke to get to shore. I had not reckoned with the current, and my evening swim became a struggle to remain afloat. As the shore finally came nearer, I repeatedly tried to find the shingle bottom with my toes, but to no avail. Being the shore of a volcano, the beach was steep. Finally, I found a toehold and desperately threw myself above the waterline. Here, I lay panting for a quarter of an hour. It was a very narrow escape. This was confirmed the next day when two men were drowned trying to make the same short swim. The island was in fact more than 2 miles distant. The current was treacherous.
It wasn't until the end of July that the Allies agreed the next step should be the invasion of the mainland of Italy. Meanwhile, the world was changing. Following the fall of Mussolini, Italy tried secretly to make a deal with the Allies. It finally signed an armistice on 3rd of September. It involved Italy becoming not an ally, but rather a co-belligerent with Britain, France and the US. Allied troops crossed the Straits of Messina from Sicily to Reggio di Calabria the same day. But the deal wasn't announced until the afternoon of the 8th of September. The Germans had anticipated it. They started to occupy Italy the moment the armistice was announced. Italy's King Victor Emmanuel and Prime Minister Badoglio fled Rome the following day. Lacking clear instructions, Italy's army of more than 1 million men collapsed. Most were made prisoners of war. Some were executed out of hand. Some defected to the Allies. Others stayed loyal to Germany. Mussolini was rescued from imprisonment by German paratroopers. He set up a pro-Axis government in northern Italy at the end of September. The result was that Italians fought both for and against the Allies, and with each other, until the end of the war in May 1945. The Fifth Army landed on beaches near Salerno, south of Naples, on the 9th of September. Allied forces captured Taranto on the same day. All-out war had started on the Italian mainland. It lasted 20 months and was to be the Irish Brigade's greatest test. But no one knew that when its marching troops set sail from the port of Milazzo on Sicily's north coast. They were fit and tanned. Depleted ranks had been replenished. The sun was shining and the sea was calm. Italy had given up. Surely it wouldn't be long before Germany did the same.
On the 24th of September 1943, the marching troops of the Irish Brigade set sail from the port of Milazzo behind me. Their destination was the mainland of Italy. And that's where we're going next, for part 4 of All My Brothers, the story of the Irish Brigade in the Second World War.
When the English came, how did you feel?
When it was all over?
Yes. How did you feel when the English came? When the English came into the town?
It was in the evening. The bells were ringing, happy bells. But we didn't leave the country where we were hiding. The next morning, the people took to the streets and filled the streets. We were clapping and there were feasts. After some days, the English came up from Fiumefreddo. All the people were looking out from the balconies. People on the balconies had vases with flowers. They threw flowers at them and they wished to thank them for liberating us.
You were happy. You were happy. Why were you happy?
We were free at last. We could do whatever we wanted.
Potevamo fare quello che volevamo.